Hi, José Manuel.
Hi, Liz.
José Manuel, you're chairman of Goldman Sachs International and a seasoned statesman, having served as president of the European Commission and also prime minister of Portugal. The European leaders have just met via video conference to approve an economic relief package. What's your assessment of the measures that they agreed on?
I think it was a good meeting, a step in the right direction, but let's be frank, a lot remains to be done. So the European leaders endorsed the package that had been proposed by the Eurogroup, group of finance ministers of the euro area. And it's a package of around 540 billion euros coming from the European Stability Mechanism, coming from the European Investment Bank, and also a program proposed by the European Commission to support employment. And this was certainly important. It is also important that they have agreed on a recovery plan in principle. Now they've asked the European Commission to come with formal proposals for this recovery plan. And that's where a lot of work has to be done in terms of the amounts and also in terms of the concrete format of this recovery plan. But certainly the meeting was a step in the right direction. But as we know, the European Union typically takes those decisions step by step in a very incremental approach. And I believe much more has to be done.
It sounds like a lot of outstanding issues remain. Can you take us through those?
Yes, one of the most important issues is what's going to be the recovery plan, the amount for loans and for grants. Because as the markets are watching, many people think that if it's just loans, of course it will increase the burden in some member states that have less fiscal space and where the debt GDP ratio is very high. So that's why there was a discussion, not yet conclusive, about how much should be loans, how much should be grants. I believe at the end it will be a mix, because the idea of the European Commission is to link this recovery plan with the multi-financial framework. This is the budget European Union approves for 7 years. We are now, this year, coming to a close of the last MFF, my multi-financial framework, and so we should start another one the 1st of January 2021. And in the multi-financial framework, a lot of it is grants. It's the so-called structural funds and cohesion funds for the less developed regions of the European Union. So the question now is, how much is it going to be in grants and loans? And also, if it is or not accepted, that there will be some form of debt mutualization. As you know, there was a debate about having euro bonds or no euro bonds, corona bonds. I believe that in the foreseeable future, there will be not this kind of euro bonds, but it is possible to find a compromise around some form of debt mutualization using precisely guarantees from the multi-financial framework, from the European Union budget. And in this case, the European Union could go to the market and raise capital for this response, not only to the pandemic, but also to the very serious and unprecedented economic and social effects that we are going to feel in Europe and also in other parts around the world. There is also another important issue is how is this going to be distributed? And this is also a very polarizing question in Europe. I've been in my previous life, I've been in 4 negotiations in different capacities of this 7-year financial framework, and I can tell it's extremely difficult. So because the countries of the so-called cohesion group, they would like to keep, of course, as much as possible of the packages they feel they are entitled to. But what happens is that some of the countries that have now been more affected by this pandemic are not exactly the same. So there will be also a very important distributional discussion. And that, from my point of view, most likely will take time. But at the end, I believe that at the end, a compromise should come. Also because I see now a better climate in terms of the predisposition of some countries, namely Germany, and Chancellor Merkel was very clear on that, to commit more resources to this, challenge. Because people understand that if some countries in Europe are very asymmetric affected, that will be, of course, very negative for them. But it is also going to be bad for all of the euro area and for the European Union.
So that'll be the focus, hopefully, in the short term. But how do you think the pandemic will impact the longer term priorities of the EU, things like the green transition and the digital transformation?
Very interesting point, Liz. I believe that the European Union and the European institutions, namely the European Commission, are going to keep those priorities very clear, namely the Green Deal and the digital transition. Having said that, I'm not so sure that the governments now, faced with the urgency of a response, for instance, to create jobs, because the unemployment is going to rise, that they will give the same level of priority, for instance, to the climate agenda than before, because even if they are committed, and I believe by and large European countries are committed to a strong action in climate terms, I believe the results, they don't see the results as quickly as other more short-term measures. So it's going to be challenging, in my opinion, to keep the same level of ambition for climate action at European Union level, namely when some of the most important partners of Europe outside are not committing to the same kind of effort. But there are other areas where I see a boost, very likely boost, like, for instance, digitization. Because we are seeing in this crisis that there is much more use of digital means. And in some of our countries, this was not yet so popular, including in terms of e-trade, or also in terms of the financial sector. So that is one of the lessons learned. And also because the Europeans now are much more attentive to the issues of their autonomy. And they believe that digitization is critically important, not only for the sector itself, but as a horizontal contribution to all the economy, from the industry to trade.
How Europe governs itself is already an evolving issue. How do you think the pandemic will impact that?
I think this pandemic will probably widen and deepen some trends that we were already witnessing before the health emergency. The European Union was becoming much more aware of some global challenges, also because of the relations between China and the United States of America. And so there were already calls, not only from Brussels, but from the main capitals, asking for more European sovereignty or a more geopolitical perspective when the European Union takes decisions. That's why, in my opinion, the European Union is going to become now more political in matters of trade, competition, regulation, data protection. And this is the developments I think we are going to witness in the medium and long term. There is one thing that I believe it's important to understand when we assess the decisions at European Union level. By definition, it's a very complex and complicated process. European Union are today 27 countries. So it's not one country like the United States of America or in another political system, China or any other country. So if decisions are difficult to take in a democracy, you can imagine they are much more difficult to take by 27 different democracies. It takes time. It's sometimes very frustrating, but it's incremental, step by step, sometimes fragmented approach. But typically, at the end, there is some type of compromise. So I believe the decisions that are being taken now are certainly in the right direction, but not sufficient. Let's hope that at the end, they come to a positive compromise that will reflect, of course, a joint commitment for the European Union.
Thank you, José Manuel.
Thank you, Liz.